Welcome everybody to the Equal Opportunities Committee. It's the 13th meeting of 2015. Can I ask you to put any electronic devices into flight mode or switch off, please? I'd like to start with introductions. We're supported at the table by the clerk and research staff, official reporters and broadcasting services, and around the room by security office, and also welcome to those observers in the public gallery. My name is Margaret McCulloch and I'm the committee's convener, and members will now introduce themselves in turn, starting here on my right.
Hey, good morning. It's Sandra White, MSP for Glasgow Kelvin, deputy convener.
Martin Farr, good morning. John Finney, MSP Highlands and Islands.
Good morning. Krishna Rad, MSP for the North East of Scotland.
Good morning. I'm Jane Baxter, MSP for Mid Scotland and Fife.
John Mason, MSP for Glasgow Shettleston.
Thank you. Today we have one agenda item, an evidence session on removing barriers on race, ethnicity and employment inquiry. I welcome the panel and can I ask the witnesses to introduce themselves. Can I also ask the witnesses, invite the witnesses to outline the work of their organisations and any current projects you're actually doing. Can I start with yourself, please?
Good morning, my name is Akwugo Emejulu. I'm a senior lecturer at the University of Edinburgh, and I'm also the co-director for the Centre for Education for Racial Equality in Scotland. My research interests focus on the political sociology of race and exploring racial and ethnic inequalities in Scotland and beyond.
Okay, my name's Dr. Gina Netto, and I'm associate professor in the Institute of Social Housing. Housing and environment and real estate at Heriot University. I have a long-standing interest in issues related to race and ethnicity, and in more recent years I've been concentrating particularly at the sharper end of extreme poverty, looking at issues related to low-paid work, extreme housing exclusion, and most latterly looking at destitution among a number of different groups. That's been an ongoing area of interest for a number of years.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Olawale Olabamiji. I'm a solicitor working with Ethnic Minority Law Centre in Glasgow. Ethnic Minority Law Centre was established in 1991 to provide free advice and representation to minority ethnic community that have problems in our area of practice, which are immigration, employment, discrimination, and criminal injury. We also have an office established in Edinburgh in 2006 to provide the same service. Presently, I part coordinate a project funded by Big Lottery for the next 3 years to extend our services to the whole of Scotland. And in recent times, we have been trying to, and we also provide training to other advisory agencies across the length and breadth of Scotland in our area of practice. And and we also have second tier advice system whereby people or minority ethnic people that have problem in our area of practice phoning to ask questions on how they can come out of their problems. That's what we do in minority ethnic.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Chris Oswald. I'm the Head of Policy and Communications at the Equality and Human Rights Commission in Scotland. The EHRC is a GB body working across England, Scotland and Wales. We both promote equality across the nine strands of equality covered by the Equality Act, and we also have a small legal casework service as well, where we both take cases and intervene in other cases. We have full primacy over equal opportunities legislation across Great Britain. We share our human rights remit in Scotland with the Scottish Human Rights Commission. There are about seven or eight specific projects which relate to race equality and employment that we're involved in just now. I could list them just now, or they may just come up, I think, as we go through discussions.
That's fine. Thank you very much. Can I ask when you want to answer a question, if you indicate to myself or the clerk on my left-hand side that you want to speak, and we'll take it in turns. And we'll start now with John Mason.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. Obviously, we're looking at the whole area of race, ethnicity and employment, and for many people, the starting point, if for young people especially, is modern apprenticeships. And we're kind of getting the impression that really there are not a proportionate share of people from black and ethnic minorities getting a share of modern apprenticeships. So I'd like to start off by asking for your comments in that area, if you think that is the case, if you think there's a problem, and so on.
Chris?
Thank you. We published the first research into modern apprenticeships or apprenticeship schemes across Great Britain 2 years ago, and that was the first time that the ethnic minority data became visible. Prior to that, Skills Development Scotland had only really published gender data. The most recent data that I have seen came out about 2 or 3 weeks ago. 1.4% of modern apprenticeships in Scotland are held by ethnic minorities, against a base population which we would say as a minimum would be 4%. If you look specifically at areas like Glasgow, you would expect that base population to be far, far higher. Obviously in areas like Orkney, you would expect it to be far lower. But this has been a persistent problem from the time when we first looked at the data in 2012. We have been working with, particularly with the employability team alongside the Wood Commission. And there are three issues which we have particularly highlighted both to Wood and also to the Scottish Government and also in conversation with Skills Development Scotland. And those are the current unreliability of the data. We do not capture in Scotland data about applications for modern apprenticeships. So whilst we know the result, the 1.4%, we don't know how many people are actually applying for those. The second issue is that there have been no targets in place. So for many years, it would appear that Skills Development Scotland have not been keeping as close an eye on this area as a public body bound by the Equality Act and the specific duties as we would expect. So we have encouraged both through Wood and also in our conversations with Skills Development Scotland to start to establish targets, not quotas, but targets for attainment. And then the third area of work which we've been involved in with Skills Development Scotland is specifically about procurement and contracting, so that the responsibility, as public money is dispersed to colleges, to employers, to training providers, that those targets and the desire of the government to boost ethnic minority participation is reflected in the contracts. And that's something which we've been working on most recently with Skills Development Scotland.
Okay, can I ask you, the 1.4% or what, obviously different in different places, is that spread across all types of apprenticeships? Or, I mean, do you see that there's particular subjects or particular areas that are doing better or doing worse or whatever?
The most recent data and the quarterly data that's published doesn't go into that sort of detail. Right. It doesn't go into the specific ethnicities either. So there, we have a global figure. It could be that there are no Chinese people participating. They could be the entire cohort. We simply don't know that.
Okay.
That would be something that Skills Development Scotland would be able to answer. From memory, and again, I can go back to the research and supply the committee with written evidence, there was a bias towards administration, towards more public service areas. Areas like construction, which is one of the big areas of modern apprenticeship, were particularly weak, and I think that's reflected in the census data as well, that you see particularly low numbers of ethnic minority people in those types of industries. I think the other industries, off the top of my head or from my notes, can I come back to
yes,
that?
That's right. Yes,
yeah,
that's good.
If you wish that.
Gina?
Yeah, I just would like to say that we did carry out a major study on low-paid work in both Scotland and England, and it was found that modern apprenticeships, where they were used by ethnic minorities, were seen as very valuable. But in that study also, it was just a very small number of ethnic minorities who had actually been through the modern apprenticeship schemes. But certainly, along with the other, because it was a study which included ethnic minorities as well as the white majority, the benefits of modern apprenticeships were clear, equally valuable to people from ethnic minority groups as they were to the majority population. And I'd suggest that there's a need really for much greater publicity about the nature of these apprenticeships, and about what they involve, you know, the valuable bridge that it provides between training and employment, because especially given the disproportionate representation of ethnic minorities in low-paid work, it's a very valuable route, especially within a wider context of growing in work poverty. Actually, for all groups, you know, it's a very valuable means of moving beyond low-paid work, and also, of course, including ethnic minorities within that. So I'd say a need for much more positive action to kind of promote the modern apprenticeships to diverse sections of the population, to involve voluntary organizations and ethnic minority community organizations in work to improve the uptake of modern apprenticeships from diverse communities. Perhaps Skills Scotland can work a little bit more closely with both training providers as well as community organizations to increase the uptake of modern apprenticeships. Also, there's a need for employers to be more aware that when they are recruiting apprentices for modern apprenticeships, a need to make employers more aware of the need to recruit from a diverse workforce and to make sure that training opportunities are available across all sections of the workforce. What we found in our study among low-paid workers is that there are, in many public sector organizations, adhere to formal equal opportunities policies and processes. But in terms of informal processes, so for example, access to training, access to development opportunities, which are often informal, there can be exclusionary practice. So there's much greater need to, I think, you know, there's been quite a lot of progress in terms of recognition of formal equal opportunities policies and practices, but a need also to be more sensitive to informal processes which can actually exclude people from benefiting from developmental opportunities to escape from
So given that, I mean, the modern apprenticeship would be linked to a job,
yes.
Would you say, I mean, is it the employer is the main most important person in this to change things?
Well, I think it's a complex picture, you know, because the employers certainly, but also in terms of employers have a role in terms of whom they recruit, you know, whom they identify as appropriate for modern apprenticeships, but also in terms of widening knowledge about modern apprenticeships to the population at large, you know, including minority groups who may not know about modern apprenticeships, and community organizations also who may not realize that there's a lot of investment, government investment in modern apprenticeships.
And basically from what Mr. Oswald said, we actually don't know that because we don't know who's applying, so we don't know if people are applying and not getting them, or as you say, they don't know about it, therefore they wouldn't be applying.
So there could well be barriers, yes, there at that point, yes, you know, in terms of applications, in terms of actual applications, as well as who's actually being informed about them.
Okay, we go?
I just want to add to what Gina and Chris have saying is we need to look a little bit earlier and look at the educational pathways for minority ethnic young people. Because remember, for the most part, minority ethnic young people have better educational outcomes than their white counterparts. Yes. And so in many ways, modern apprenticeships are not for them in many ways because they're overperforming. And so this isn't a traditional group that would necessarily see that modern apprenticeships are for them. Yes. So there's something else that we have to look at here. So there may well be barriers. There may well be a process of not knowing enough information about apprenticeships, but is it actually kind of fit for purpose for an incredibly highly skilled, highly qualified young workforce? So I think there's perhaps maybe a mismatch between educational outcomes and the role and purpose of apprenticeships to begin with.
Right. So it potentially, I'm not saying it is, but potentially it could be a good thing that there's fewer ethnic minority people in modern apprenticeships because more of them are doing academic and they're doing other forms of education?
Well, no, because then when you look at the labour market outcomes for minority ethnic young people, they're still unemployed and underemployed, yes, and yes, over-concentrated in low-skilled, low-paid work. So there's still a problem here. So there's still an ethnic penalty that minority ethnic young people experience, whether that's in terms of, well, we don't have the data clearly, whether that's in terms of accessing apprenticeships or when they're out in the labour market, something is still going, well, institutionalized racism is what's going on that, you know, depresses their outcomes. And so there's something going on here, but I guess I just feel I think what's important to note is modern apprenticeships are not the, you know, not the magic bullet here, because we see different kinds of educational aspirations for minority ethnic young people. And so this will only capture a small but important group, but not, maybe it doesn't kind of, it doesn't address the broader issue.
And when you say there's different aspirations, because I thought your paper was very interesting, and you were making the point there are a huge range of ethnic minorities, those who have been here for two or three generations and have tremendous English and so on, but others who maybe come in and struggling. So would there be a variety within that about the aspirations? Yes,
absolutely. But in the paper provided by Susie McPherson for Spice, you know, she outlined it incredibly well, how regardless of the ethnic background, all minority ethnic young people, whether they arrived in 2007 or they've been here for three or four generations, are still performing better, and they're not seeing any kind of benefit in the labor market as a result. So there's, you know, so we have to take seriously this issue of institutionalized discrimination in the labor market, and targeting apprenticeships better for minority ethnic young people is just only one small part of that process.
Gina, and then
Olawale.
Yes. Yeah. Please.
Okay, as Akwugo continued, she covered some of the points I wanted to cover, but to say also that it's not a uniform picture. Aspirations are changing, and we shouldn't presume that modern apprenticeships may not be attractive to some sections of the population. I mean, there are particularly some very deprived communities, minority ethnic communities, who might well find these apprenticeships very attractive, because at the moment there is such a the problem of unemployment is very high in certain communities, and you know, modern apprenticeships provide a route into employment which people might well take up, even if they might be viewed as overqualified. They might well see that this is a route into employment which I would not otherwise benefit from. You know, so these opportunities do need to be publicized, as well as we need to kind of have a closer look at the nature of the apprenticeships, you know, to make sure that the apprenticeships themselves are appropriate for people with different skills levels, different qualifications levels, and that it is also seen as a measure not just into a route into employment, but a route into career progression, you know, so it's part of a working to learn culture within organizations. So the apprenticeship schemes should be seen more broadly as tools for working to learn, to promote working to learn environments within organizations, as opposed to learning to work cultures within organizations.
Can I ask you, when you're replying, to keep your answers concise? We've got quite a few people that want to come in.
Okay, sorry.
Over to yourself, Olawale.
Thank you very much, Margaret. And I think this barrier to career progression, for instance, is even more pronounced when you look at legal profession, for instance, whereby you are expected to have 2 years of traineeship. Apart from Ethnic Minority Law Centre in Scotland, I am not so aware of other organizations. I stand to be corrected in any case, whereby people from minority ethnic background have opportunity to gain access into mainstream legal profession. And I think it's more pronounced here in Scotland than in England.
Okay, thank you. John Finney.
Thank you, Convener. Maybe a dangerous question to ask a panel with two academics on it, but I'm going to ask it anyway. We obviously receive a lot of papers, and we're grateful for the information we've had from yourselves, and notwithstanding what Chris has said about some research there, we're advised there's a dearth of robust data that would inform our decision-making. And I don't want to suggest that the rest of our morning is wasted, but are these gaps so sufficient that we can't draw an accurate picture, probably is what I'm...
Gaps. What gaps are you referring to specifically?
I'm referring to the gaps I'm told exist in the range of data that we have.
Oh, yeah.
There isn't robust enough information for around which to draw absolute conclusions.
Yes. I mean, in some senses, yes. But in other respects, no. Because if you were to, well, if you look at the other end, the other end of the spectrum, if you like, looking at the top jobs, for example, you know, then it's almost... across the board. They're very small numbers. As you go higher up the organizational ladder, the representation of ethnic minorities becomes smaller and smaller. I think that's a fairly clear picture in terms of organizational representation within public sector organizations, within local authorities, within the NHS. It's a fairly clear picture as to that.
Can I come in on that, though? If we're talking about data, how can you actually get up-to-date data when it's down to the individual, when they're completing their own application to actually identify what background they actually come from? Because it's up to an individual to say if they're white or Asian or whatever, or disabled. So how are you going to really have 100% accurate information if that information's voluntary? Chris?
This is an area that we're particularly looking at just now from the Commission, because we're assessing the performance of public bodies in terms of all of the employment data that they had to publish across different characteristics in April the 30th this year. And there are big gaps in that data. I'm not particularly singling out Greater Glasgow Health Board for any other reason than I recall it, but in Greater Glasgow Health Board, 75% of people declared their ethnicity. That means that 10,000 members of staff did not. That's such a huge gap that you can't really say anything particularly meaningful. We also find that GB data is often collapsed around employment into very, very broad categories like Asian or African and Caribbean. So the granularity, what we really need, because the outcomes for different communities are wildly different sometimes. There is, I think, definite. So in terms of how do we encourage more people to do that, we're currently working with the Scottish Government and Close the Gap, the Equal Pay Project, specifically to look at what the reasons for the data gaps are. Sometimes they're administrative, they don't have the systems in place to do this. But particularly, are there issues about the questions that are being asked which are putting people off? I think the interesting thing is that the question that is asked is very often the census question, which had a very high completion rate. What we hear back from public bodies, and I think this would be mirrored by private sector as well, is that whilst they are able to capture data reasonably reliably about new starts, it's the group of people who have been in place for a long time that they have particular difficulty capturing that data from. Mr. Finney makes a good point, but I don't think we can say there's nothing that we can draw from the data, but we have to accept that the data is incomplete and at times unreliable, but the data only tells you the outcome. What it doesn't tell you, and where I think the real difficulty in terms of research, where we need more research, is that why are there concentrations of groups in particular industries? Why hasn't that changed particularly over time? And what is it that is creating the barrier? Is it a lack of information, or is it a lack of desire to go into particular areas of industry?
Okay, thanks. Now, I've got two of the committee members would like to come in very briefly on the back of that, and then we need to move on to the next question. And it's Christian and then Sandra. Are you okay, Christian?
Thanks very much, Governor. Just a point of clarification on two of the data. The first one, Chris, of all, you said 1.4% only of BMEs are going into a modern data partnership, and that's in a population of 4%. But after what Dr. Emejulu said, and we've got the data here, that a lot of people are going into higher education. Is that difference of 3% could be just explained by this? Have we done some research into this?
I would very much agree there is a huge spectrum of experience. We see particular ethnic minority groups, but I think largely overall, there's far higher people, numbers of people involved in higher and further education. So yes, that's one explanation. Particular in some particular ethnic minority groups, Pakistani community, in particular, women's economic activity in that critical age range is far, far lower. So we have
the issue.
Yes. But that isn't carried across to other ethnic groups as well. So there is a real variation. But I think, yes, you're more likely to see people in higher education. You're more likely to see people unemployed. You're also more likely to see, in some communities, far lower levels of economic activity.
And the second point, and that's very important for our inquiry, Dr. Emejulu, you talked about people more likely to be in low pay and low skill work. But this data we are collecting includes all the people who are coming as migrants, as adults. Mm-hmm. So they're not being in the education system. So it makes it very, very difficult to compare the data of education to the place of work. How could we, you know, how would you suggest we run our inquiry to make sure that we don't get confused? But when we talk about people in employment, how can we separate the people who've not been educated here from the people who've been educated here? Mm.
Well, the very straightforward thing, and this is what I argue in my paper, is that we have to have a much more subtle and complex understanding of who we mean by ethnic minority. Mm-hmm. Because at the moment, the way in which it's treated, it's everyone who's not a white Scot. And that's not sufficient because I guess I'm an ethnic minority. I'm American, and I live here. I've been here for about 15 years. But so my experience is lumped in with Polish migrants, which is lumped into fourth-generation Scottish-Pakistani groups. How is that? What do we all have in common besides not being a white Scot? And so there's something quite important that I would strongly encourage, if I can do that, strongly encourage the committee to do, is to be clear about who you mean. And so if you want to capture the experiences of recent migrants from Eastern Europe, say that, but don't use the label as such of minority ethnic, because then people will say, but are you talking about people who are born and bred in Scotland, but are non-white, but are people of color. So I think that's the issue about being specific about who you mean, so you can better track people. And just to, I'm sorry, I know you wanted to move on, but just to go back to this, Mr. Finney's point about, do we have enough data? Yes. Yes, we do have enough data. There's a question about monitoring, there's a question about how public bodies capture and analyze data. But I'm sitting next to one of the leading researchers in Scotland who's been doing this work for almost 20 years. We know what the problem is. We know what the issue is, and the issue is. The issue is institutionalized racism, and the issue is a lack of real action to address these problems. We know what the issue is, and I don't think we should confuse the problem.
There was no criticism fair in the question, indeed. It offers you the opportunity.
No, that's why I'm like, but I'm getting all revved up. So, and so I guess, it's not a question of want of data, because I do a lot of sociological research to actually try to explain the whys and the hows of why there isn't enough action being taken. And so I think it's important not to confuse the issue of the problems of collecting data via public bodies with the actual lived experiences of educational and labour market inequality.
Okay, thank you. And we'll move on to the next questions from Jane Baxter.
Still on the theme of employment support advice and employability, I'd like to explore whether you think there's anything additional or things that could be done better by the various support agencies, and with the aim of improving the outcomes for ethnic minority customers and people who are seeking employment. What could be done better or differently?
I think you could... Sorry.
No, it's fine. On you go.
I think, again, it's important to disentangle, for example, the needs, for example, of people who are newly arrived, so refugees, asylum seekers, refugees who are allowed to work. Their primary needs for many of them, not all, but for many of them, would be access to ESOL classes, so there's a great need for those classes to ensure that they've got access to a vital stepping stone into the labour market. So the requirements of new migrants are very different for entering into the labour market, are very different from those who are born and brought up in Scotland and who see Scotland as their home. And this is where there's a lot of work really to be done in terms of widening opportunities available for people in terms of careers advice in schools, in terms of the work that the voluntary organizations undertake with young people, in terms of outreach work by employers
who are interested in setting up major employers who've got access to apprenticeship, you know, who will be using apprenticeship schemes. So a lot of outreach work which can be undertaken. And some of these work, some of this work can be taken in a very targeted way. You know, it's Chris spoke about targets, you know, but also the work can be targeted geographically. So you could go to areas where you know, for example, within Glasgow, where certain, you know, established minority groups live. And you can target those areas specifically and say there are these opportunities here. You know, so far we don't seem to have many people from ethnic minorities applying, you know, and just kind of make simple statements. These are opportunities that are open to all. And I think that despite the higher proportion of people who with, you know, with, despite having good educational qualifications, there will be interest because the alternative is either unemployment or working in family businesses, and aspirations are changing. The young people don't want to work in, you know, don't want to work in the shops owned by family businesses, and they've got wider aspirations. Not all of them, of course, some of them will pursue family businesses, but there are wider, you know, others will be interested in wider opportunities and will see it as a stepping stone. You know, they're already armed with educational qualifications, so they might well see it as a stepping stone.
I was very struck by some questions that Liam MacArthur, MSP, was raising about head teachers and the complete absence of ethnic minority head teachers in Scotland. And this was from data which is almost complete, so we can rely on that. And this raises the question of positive action. Across Great Britain, positive action programmes are lawful. Positive discrimination is not, except in very exceptional circumstances. So where you have, say, a profession...
later, the positive action.
Pardon me?
We'll come on to that part about positive action later.
Shall I away from that just now?
Yes,
then?
Just now. Thank you. Yeah, okay. Anything else you want to say regarding that?
No.
No, okay. Okay. Olawale.
Well, based on our own experience of people, of minority ethnic people who come to access our service, we discover that majority of them are highly educated, but they are underemployed. Mm-hmm. And we believe they are, for them to be able to gain access to employment, there must be something in place for them to acquire experience, which employers are actually looking at, which they are going to be looking out for, because they are more often than not overqualified. You have PhD students, people with PhD who are doing cleaning, as in people that have master's degree who are working in care homes. But because there is no opportunity of something like volunteering, we don't really have that data to be able to establish that. Oh, but I think there is a kind of a barrier in gaining experience that will enable them to move into mainstream employment sector.
Sandra wants to come in the back of this.
Thank you. I just wanted to clarify and pick up on what I think Gina had said also. When you mentioned people with PhD and masters, etc., of working in care homes and cleaning, are these migrants who have came in to the country, or they've been born and bred and got the PhD, but they can't get a job to that level? Because I think it's important, as you had said, Gina, that we need to focus, you know, on various groups. So the people you're speaking to, are these migrants that have came in and that's the only job they've been offered?
Who would like to answer? Olawale.
Okay. Most of them are migrants.
Yeah.
While some of them are minority ethnic people that are born here.
Yeah. I just wanted to clarify that point because, as Gina had already mentioned, if you're coming up through the system, the educational system, there's a gap there where you're not attaining. And then there's a difference in migrants coming in with the qualifications but can't get that job.
Thank you. I think because of the immigration, because of the necessity to, like, wanting to extend their visa so that they can live legally in United Kingdom, most migrants tend to, like, wanting to progress their educational career so as to, like, attain the 10 years requirement of applying for settlement in United Kingdom. And as a result of that, they realize that they have been studying for a very long period of time. They don't have
opportunity of like putting what they have been learning into practice that will now result into them gaining employment in the mainstream sector. I think maybe if something can be done in this area, it will assist migrants in that class, in that category, from moving, I mean, progressing there.
Okay, thanks, Jane.
Okay, thank you. And in terms of all those agencies who are delivering employment support, do you think there's an appetite amongst them to get better at what they're doing? Are there any incentives for them to improve their outcomes? And what can we do to incentivise? Is it carrot or stick? How do we get those agencies to address this issue and work harder to achieve better outcomes?
I think public... On you go, Gina. On you go.
Well, public sector equality duties are one, you know, in ensuring, for example, that organisations take seriously their public sector equality duties is one route, you know, in monitoring that, reviewing, monitoring that, looking at whether organisationally encouraging organisations to review their progress in terms of making sure their organisation, their workforce is diverse, you know, and it reflects the local population. And that will vary from area to area. Mm-hmm. So, for example, in the Highlands and Islands, you know, you might have a different picture than from in Glasgow, you know. So it's being sensitive to the kind of local population and making sure that organisations, particularly like the NHS, like local authorities, that they reflect the local population that they serve. Because, of course, having the people from the local community within those organisations will enable them to provide better services to those groups as well as providing employment.
Okay. Chris?
I would very much agree with Gina that the public sector duty is absolutely central here. The problem, I think, is that the vast majority of the public sector has been downsizing for the last 8 or 9 years rather than recruiting. So ethnic minorities are attempting to penetrate into organisations which are shrinking at the same time. So it's an unfortunate coincidence. But I think it then becomes particularly incumbent on those bodies which have responsibilities under the public sector duty, particularly around training, around education, around development, that they are putting additional effort in here. And I'd say, I mean, certainly in terms of Skills Development Scotland and the contractual arrangements that they may have had with colleges or training providers, that type of push has not been evident. I think it's starting to become far more evident now, but the race equality duty has been in force in one way or another since 2002. So we have a long time that these public bodies could and should have been directing their effort towards these areas, and we're not seeing a significant change. Whilst you can't make direct comparisons between apprenticeship schemes in Scotland, England and Wales, I think it's interesting that in England and Wales, ethnic minority participation in apprenticeship schemes is more or less at the level that you would expect. In Scotland, it is very unusually lower.
Can I come in on that as well when we're talking about employment support and advice? The statistics that we've got from the Scottish Government, the pupil census, it actually says the Chinese group achieve the highest qualifications. Is there any work done on speaking to these groups at that point when they leave the education system to actually monitor what their choice is and where they go, what is their destination when they leave the school or further or higher education, to get a feel for what their choice is about employment? Akwugo, and then Chris.
Just to say very briefly, there is some interesting work about kind of transitions. Mm-hmm. And what we see is that for the most part, you know, speaking very broadly, for those minority ethnic young people who enter higher education and then leave, you know, concentrated in professional and in the professions, solicitor, engineers, all the rest, kind of identifiable professions. And so that's what I was saying before about the mismatch between mm-hmm. apprenticeships and educational aspirations and outcomes. That, you know, absolutely, and you know, because most, at least the stereotype is most apprenticeships are about, oh, getting into kind of construction and all those kinds of things. That's not necessarily matched by kind of what minority ethnic young people tell us about what, where they see their future careers. So there's, that's what I was saying again about the issue of the mismatch.
So what's needing done in schools then to actually better inform the pupils of various options then, Chris?
I think Chinese and Indian communities are particularly interesting in these areas because in the Indian community, the census suggests that just under 40% of the Indian community are involved in some kind of wholesale retail activity. In the Chinese community, about a third of the community is involved in catering or hotel areas. I think what we're seeing is a generational divide that we see significant. Particularly in Indian and Chinese communities, parents are investing significantly in their children's success, that they are directing their children towards professions and universities, often at their own expense. Now, I can't prove this, but it's a common pattern of migration that you defer your own success for that of your children's. We're seeing that lesser to an extent, I think, in other communities. But again, I think it's... If we concentrate solely on young people, we're missing a huge pool of talent, people who have high qualifications, but who have settled for service industry work, which is obviously in the middle of a recession, is very precarious, to concentrate on their children's success going forward. So I think we're seeing differences both between communities, but also quite sharply inside communities, and inside genders, inside communities as well.
Okay, thanks. Very briefly, John Mason, and very brief answer.
That would kind of suggest that if we wait a generation, it's going to sort itself out.
Unfortunately, the data that I've been looking at across 91 census, 2001 census, suggests that we're not, and that we still have these very high concentrations, particularly in Asian and Chinese communities, in service industries, which, as I say, are... And that seems to be rolling through generations. It doesn't quite make sense the way that I would agree with you. It should make sense. But it does suggest that people's perhaps employment aspirations are being blunted at some point, and they're then going into traditional family businesses, areas which they perceive as being safe. Self-employment, as we know, is far higher amongst ethnic minority communities than it is across the general community.
Can we move on now to John Finney?
Thank you, Kavina. We've covered some of the background that's given rise to workplace discrimination, and it's a question for Chris and Olawale. And are these issues being reflected in discrimination cases that are coming to you, and to what extent are we learning lessons from these cases then?
All right. Thank you very much. From our own experience, because most people that come to us are minority ethnic people, and in terms of discrimination in employment places, we can say to a large extent that when clients complain of being discriminated against, majority of them pinch it on their race, that, oh, my employer is doing this to me, and I believe it's because of my nationality, it's because of my color, but there is another problem that we found out, especially with the introduction of employment fee at the tribunal. We've realized that it has significantly reduced the number of discrimination that gets to the employment tribunal. Because when someone alleges that he has been discriminated against by his employer, and, for instance, maybe he has suffered unjust dismissal, and is also at the same time expected to pay £1,200 to be able to lodge his claim at the employment tribunal. This is somebody that has not worked for like maybe 2 months, he doesn't have money. And at the end of the day, we realize that most discrimination, especially based on race, we go unreported. We not proceed to employment tribunal stage. And at the same time, again, apart from that, because minority ethnic people, in quote, are vulnerable when it comes to employment. Some of them would rather not report discrimination. They would rather prefer to keep their job. They would rather prefer to be at the receiving end. Oh, I don't want to sue my employer because it took me like 4 years to get a job. If I take them to court, where am I going to get another job? So we realize that it goes on and on, on and on until maybe, for instance, our client feels that, oh, there is nothing I can do at this moment. I just have to sue my employer. So it's going to go on report. Most of them go unreported. Most of them will not proceed to tribunal stage because of the employment fee and because majority of them will want to keep their job because they knew what they go through before they got the job.
Thank you, John.
Chris, sorry. I have the data on employment fee applications for Scotland in front of me. In 2012-13, there was 157 race cases. In 13-14, there were 90. This year, to date, and I'm lacking about a third of the data, there were 65. So there's definitely a drop, but if you compare it to sex discrimination and equal pay claims, where they have been decimated, the drop hasn't been as distinct. I think the interesting thing, and I very much agree here, is that people do not want to go to tribunal. It's the absolute last card that you can throw down on the table. There has never been a high number of race discrimination cases going through in Scotland. Clearly, they've been affected, but I think people find other ways to deal with the discrimination. That may be by walking away, it may be just accepting that this is unfair, but they can't do anything about it. I think the fees have had an impact, but in terms of race discrimination, it's nothing like the impact that we've seen on equal pay, or particularly around sex discrimination.
Gina?
Can I add, that I think when we did this, I alluded to a major study we did on low-paid work a couple of years ago, and what that showed, interesting patterns of discrimination in the sense that the most blatant forms of discrimination were not evident. What people were talking about were more subtle forms of discrimination. So, for example, access to training, access to developmental opportunities, seeing some colleagues being taken under the wing, being offered opportunities, given advice, and others feeling excluded from that. So that kind of more subtle discrimination, not knowing about all the opportunities that are available. And part of it is really, it's really quite subtle. It's kind of workplace cultures, who's in, who's part of the mainstream, who's on the margins, so I think as well as looking at formal equal opportunities policies and processes, attention is needed really more on the informal aspects. They're too intertwined because if you don't hear about developmental opportunities, if you don't hear about access to training, then you don't get to benefit from them, and then you don't get the opportunities to progress within the workforce. So it's quite closely related, the informal and the formal. And other forms of discrimination people were talking about were in terms of volume of work. So, for example, some migrants felt that they were seen to be physically stronger, for example. We're talking about people in low-paid work. So they were given more responsibility because of their physical strength. Other forms and other more highly skilled people said they were given more in terms of complexity to do, that they felt that people at the same level, their jobs were not as complex as their own. So these have to be interpreted quite carefully because it's qualitative research and it's how people perceive their treatment. But there was enough evidence, across the different, when we talked to a wide range of different people to kind of substantiate some of this, that it didn't seem to be isolated examples. There seemed to be a pattern in terms of the kind of more subtle forms of discrimination that takes place in our workplaces.
Thank you. Olawale.
And thank you very much. And going forward, when we realize that majority of minority ethnic people that access our service in terms of employment matter, complaints of racial discrimination, and I hope I'm not jumping gun at this moment, we began to like going from secondary school to, I mean, from different secondary school to educate them. We have a project which we refer to as YDP, Youth Discrimination Workshop, whereby because we realize that most of these things are just stereotypes and it stems out of somehow like cultural differences. So we began to take positive action by going from secondary school to secondary school, educate them on how they can report it, how they can report discrimination, how they can deal with it, where to go, and how to find succor if it happens. And
okay, thank you. John?
Well, I think the proponents of fees for employment tribunals have already achieved their aim, and that's rewarding bad employment practices and racial practices in the workplace. I wonder, and it's an issue that Gina touched on there, the question of promotion, but I wonder, could I take a couple of steps before that? Because what do we know about people being selected for interview and thereafter the likelihood of achieving the post if they have been called for interview? Because I think there's information about that.
Right. I mean, there is some research been conducted on this, admittedly quite a few years ago, in which you know they looked at people's success in terms of being shortlisted, and found out that people who found out that people with ethnic minority names were much less likely to be shortlisted, even though they had comparable qualifications to people from the white majority population. So they're less likely to be called for interview and less likely to be selected at interview. So that research is, you know, done some considerable time ago, but we don't have more recent research that would tell us that things are any different.
So but the promotion experience would perhaps suggest that things aren't any different because...
Yeah.
Okay, John, anything else?
No, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair. There's a number of issues that I wanted to raise. I think you've answered a number of them, and particularly, you know, about the opportunities. I think we went through a lot in regard to careers advice, outreach workers, etc., in regarding to improve employment opportunities. Would you say perhaps, and I hear what Olawale said about, you know, outreach work in schools, would you say starting in schools education is important, but perhaps we could also involve, as you say, the local communities, trade unions perhaps as well, which could give advice, particularly in apprenticeship aspects of it. Really what I'm trying to say is what measures, apart from what we've already spoken about, can we do to ensure that these opportunities are given to everyone?
Aki will go, and then Gina.
Well, I talked about in my paper that I think there's something problematic about assuming that the issue, this is an issue with labor supply. Do you know what I mean? That the issue about why minority ethnic people are not being selected for an interview or not being recruited, not being promoted, that this is somehow the problem of labor supply. And there's an issue about the deficits of people not understanding, not having the information, all the rest of it. I think it's actually important that we say, no, this is a problem for employers. And actually, the action needs to be taken by employers. And I echo the advice that Spice has given about extending the two-tick scheme that is currently in place for people with disabilities to minority ethnic candidates. Because I think it's that kind of positive action, that kind of targeted action to ensure that that minority ethnic people get some sort of kind of equality in the recruitment selection process. I think it's only when we put that kind of pressure on employers to do that we're going to see some sort of action. So that's, of course, not to say that outreach work isn't important. Of course it is. All of that is crucial. But I just have to just emphasize again that this is not a problem of, you know, this is not a problem of labor supply. This is a problem of employers not living up to their public public duties.
Mm-hmm. Yes, just to buttress the point that the last speaker has just said, I think if we look at the cause, or it's a kind of a mindset, it's a kind of a stereotype that, okay, you look at the barriers that prevent minority ethnic people from gaining employment or moving into the mainstream of their career. An example that really comes to my mind is one of my colleagues who before he shared his experience that is from minority ethnic background. And before she was able to gain the first employment, she has to change her name to reflect, because someone told him that you won't be able to get a job with this kind of long name on your CV. So, and that did magic. So it now comes to when he changed his name, and that was what our colleague narrated. And what readily comes to mind is, oh, he's from ethnic minority background, he's not going to be fluent in English, I'm going to have problem when it comes to, if he's a migrant, he's on work visa, what if his visa is coming to an end? I'm going to be responsible for extending his visa or leave to remain in the UK. So in that case, I would rather go for somebody that I know that I wouldn't have to do anything to retain him or her in my employment. So in that case, I think one thing that can be done is, and I will narrow it down to what we do, for instance, if a minority ethnic person that is on work visa loses his job today, he has within 60 days to get another job or his. Whether he has 10 children or 5 children living in the United Kingdom, he has to be out of UK within two months of losing his job. So, and that means that person will do everything to keep that job once he gets a job. And I think that comes to the issue of discrimination going unreported. Because if a similar person, if someone that is settled, someone who is British, who find himself out of job, he can go on, for instance, an EEA national can go on employment support allowance for 6 months at least. So maybe if there is a leeway like that, it will give a kind of opportunity and stability for minority ethnic people, especially who are on work visa. Based on our experience, they want to do everything to keep their job. And I think apart from running ISO classes for minority ethnic community in order to improve proficiency of their English language, that will encourage and will make them to be appealing to employers. Then, in terms of running cultural awareness training for employer, also we go a long way, because most of this thing is like a kind of a stereotype. We, based on our work, we discover that if employers become aware of other people's culture, maybe there will be a kind of a soft landing and a kind of a measure to be employing more ethnic minority.
Thank you.
Sandra. Yeah, I just wanted to sort of bring that forward a bit, and I was very interested in the two-tick system, and I know we're going to go on to that. But I wanted to ask Chris, in your line, obviously, you have the ability, the legislation, about discrimination. Would having the two-tick system basically make it easier for you when you looked at data to be able to take, action against employers who discriminate? Would that be the way forward? Or do you have enough tools in the box, basically, at the moment to take employers, to tribunals or whatever it may be in regards to discrimination?
I think it depends what we're talking about in terms of the two-tick system. Equality legislation is what we describe as being asymmetric. It is always lawful. You can always lawfully positively discriminate in favour of disabled people. And that's been a principle of equality legislation for many, many years. And that's the exception. It only applies to disabled people. If you were to prefer ethnic minority candidates at interview, you could then be accused of positive discrimination, which would be unlawful. So I think we need to be careful about what we're doing. We also know from the Scottish Social Attitudes Survey that positive discrimination, whenever it's been proposed, is deeply unpopular. So it may not actually favour people, may favour people in the short term. We don't know. Certainly, I think there needs to be a great deal more attention. In terms of...
Do you think at the moment that not you yourself, but you're doing enough to work with employers in regards to discriminatory practices?
No, I mean, if I had the control of the resourcing of the Equality and Human Rights Commission, mm-hmm. I would obviously suggest we might be getting a little bit more. I think there's a particular deficit, though, and this is something that's been pointed mm-hmm. out to me by a number of ethnic minority organisations, that, say, 10, 15 years ago, there were a lot more caseworkers on the ground. There were a lot more advice agencies on the ground. Race equality councils took mm-hmm. employment tribunal work themselves. Now there is almost very, with the exception of the Ethnic Minority Law Centre, there are very, very few skilled people on the ground that you could go to. And remember, in terms of employment law, you have 3 months to lodge a complaint. If you don't realise you've got a complaint, if you don't seek advice quickly, if you don't have somebody who is knowledgeable and experienced in that, you have no case. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. and then given that, with the disinclination of anybody, black or white, to go in front of an employment tribunal because it's a very, very stressful experience and one which could backfire on you in the future. And my emphasis would be much more on what particularly public bodies are doing, and again, particularly around areas like procurement. We've seen examples with the living wage where the Scottish Government is able to lever social benefits out of public sector procurement. I would certainly see myself like to see much more, in that sense, incentivization, but also disincentives for not doing so. I would, however, always stress that the outcome data is a combination of choice, circumstance, and also discrimination. So it's hard to say that one group is, their unemployment is purely a result of discrimination. It could also be a factor about choice, it could be a factor about education, it could be a factor about location. We've run some of the census data about Edinburgh and Glasgow. There are different employment outcomes for the same communities. So, you know.
Can I come in on that as well? And I'm just sort of thinking, you're probably about 98% of businesses are SMEs. And we know the public sector are very proactive in, you know, recruiting people from ethnic minority backgrounds. I think employers from these SME background need more information on how to access groups of ethnic minorities to advertise their vacancies. But I'm also thinking as well, and you can probably answer this, is that do you think some employers are frightened to recruit ethnic minorities in case through the sort of probationary period, maybe that individual for justifiable reasons are not doing the job satisfactorily, and then they're frightened to take them on in case when they get to that period, then they're accused of racial discrimination? Do you think that is that a possibility? And if that is the case, what can organisations like yourself do to reach out to these businesses to educate them, Gina?
I think there is no evidence that the fear is that, no evidence that I've come across that the fear is underperformance. I've not come across that at all in terms of employers' reluctance to take people on. I think in the private sector, often there are a lot of informal networks which operate, so they don't even advertise, they know people, it's through the networks, and so you get employed through that way. And sometimes, actually, to be fair, that actually works in favour for certain jobs, low-paid jobs. So, for example, you know, like a Polish network of people who are in cleaning, for example, you know, cleaning officers, if a vacancy arises, they can easily get a replacement through that network. They don't need to advertise. Mm-hmm. So you can see, you know, that works in the favour of private sector employers. But also, in the short term, it might also provide employment for people within that community. Mm-hmm. It's only low-paid work, you know, so they're kind of trapped in that type of low-paid mm-hmm. employment. Because that's what's most easily available.
Okay, thank you. Sandra, you finished? Yep. Christian?
We talked already about positive discrimination. What I would like to find out is what would be your advice for a government or for a parliament who would like to encourage positive discrimination in the tone of the debate that we have around ethnic minority and migrants today. Do you think there is a way to approach it to make sure that the public out there will understand the need of positive discrimination? Do you think that positive discrimination still have a too negative view around the general public out there?
Chris, then Gina and Akwugo.
Okay, I'll try and cover off the legal end of it. Positive discrimination is almost always unlawful. There are certain circumstances, for example, if it's a genuine occupational requirement. So, for example, Shakti Women's Aid, who deal with women who have experienced domestic abuse, could advertise for a Bangladeshi worker because of the cultural issues involved. There are very, very few other circumstances that were set out in the paper where that can happen. It's very rarely used. I don't see a particular desire to change that at the moment in Great Britain. And I would wonder what the consequences of that would be. Positive action is something entirely different, and I'd happily cover that. Okay.
It's when you talk about positive action, the public out there automatically said positive discrimination. Am I right or am I wrong?
I think you're absolutely right. We saw it just a couple of weeks ago with a BBC weatherman applying for, you know, encouraging disabled people to come forward. They weren't holding jobs for disabled people. They were just encouraging. Completely misinterpreted by the press and then the public. Should I set out just what positive action is, if that'd be helpful, briefly? Positive action, in terms of its lawful schemes, if you have an industry or a profession where you know, where you can demonstrate that there are lower numbers of applicants or successful candidates from a particular group, an ethnic minority group, a specific ethnic minority group, Chinese people, in terms of gender or disability, you can set out training courses, work experience, shadowing, all of those things which better equip people to compete. You cannot reserve posts or quotas on the basis of ethnicity. So it takes you up to the point of interview and supports you to there. Two very good examples currently happening in Scotland. Positive action training and housing have been going for many years. Relatively small operation, and I think it could be very helpfully extended. That is helping ethnic minority people get into the housing profession, where we know that there's a huge deficit. Similarly, NHS Lothian have got lottery funding to do a thing about career progression for, I think it's ethnic minority medical staff, where there has always been that accusation of a glass ceiling. It gets you to the point of having greater skills, greater knowledge, greater training. It doesn't reserve a job for you. And that's the way law is just now in Scotland. If we were to move forward from that to suggest positive discrimination, I think we would really need to have quite a serious debate about what do we mean by this and what the potential consequences may be. I'm not saying we shouldn't do it. I'm just saying I think we need to talk about it.
You know, I'd say I agree with all that Chris has said. I think in terms of positive discrimination, actually, you know, given all that we've been speaking about, you know, in terms of about people being having qualifications, but no, the issue isn't labour supply. It's the recognition of skills. And so the positive discrimination actually is not required, because my understanding of positive discrimination is that if you've got two candidates, one ethnic minority, one white, under positive discrimination, you would take the person with fewer qualifications from an ethnic minority background to increase representation within the workforce. The problem here isn't the fact that people from ethnic minority backgrounds are coming in with fewer qualifications. It's quite the reverse. It's actually making sure that they actually get recognized at the point of interview and at the point of recruitment, you know, the application and recruitment. So I don't actually see a need for positive discrimination. I do see a need for a lot more positive action and a lot more onus on employers to ensure their workforce is representative, but better awareness and embarrassment as well if it's not. Embarrassment that it's not representative. You know, in a Scotland which prides itself of being very accepting of, you know, of people from other countries, there should be embarrassment in a workforce which is not representative of that welcoming, you know, of what is typically a very welcoming attitude towards people from other countries.
Akwugo.
I guess I As long as positive discrimination is off the table, then I feel as if policymakers are not going to be able to address deep-seated racial inequalities in the labor market. And so I think as long as this is outside the realm of actual policy, then we're not going to be able to deal with many of the issues we've been talking about today. And so I disagree with my esteemed colleagues here on that point. And I would just like to, you know, we should reflect on where we do see positive discrimination. We see positive discrimination in political parties. What we've seen in the Conservative Party, in the Labour Party, and in the SNP is you can't get women to stand unless you have all female shortlists. And so political parties have done that precisely. Sorry. Well, I'm sorry, Ms. Goldie, but as you know, it's coming. So what we know is, again and again, women cannot get a seat, cannot get selected without some sort of quota system. And so clearly, the political parties have seen that unless you take some sort of positive discrimination, you're going to see systemic reproduced sexism and racism in who gets selected, who gets to represent us. So if that's the case for political parties, why are we not doing the very same things for tackling labor market discrimination? When we look at evidence in the United States with affirmative action, it has transformed the labor market, particularly for white women, and also for kind of middle class African Americans and Latinos. And so we can say that that is a policy success. And as long as we can't contemplate that, we're this is an important policy tool that's off to the side. So that's and I guess I would just kind of urge the committee to really take a leadership role in trying to shape public debate. Because yes, of course, positive discrimination is not popular. Affirmative action in the United States is not popular. But oftentimes we don't do what's popular; we do what's right. So this is a nice little kind of value judgment here about saying I would love to see a debate about how do we actually tackle in some sort of systemic way this kind of deep-seated discrimination.
Thank you. Christian?
Yeah, so how can we tackle it? How can we get whatever is positive discrimination or positive action? How can we make the public out there, and employers particularly, because you talked about the employers, you talked, Chris, about the parents as well. How do we get them buying into that idea that we need to change? You know, do we need to have a kind of campaign? Do we need to have... for example, I just participated to I'm a Migrant campaign, and that worked very well, I think. Do we need more of this type of campaign? Do we need more of this kind of recognition that we are a very diverse community?
Yes. Yeah. Well, absolutely. I mean, what you see at the moment, the success of the 50-50 campaign is fantastic. And so it's one of these things where, and the success of, getting Jane Austen on the, £5 note or the £10 note, until we actually talk openly about racism, we can't address racism. And so there's something about naming the problem. And that's part of a public debate led by elected members, but also by the public as well, that until we can talk about and name these things and say that it's going to be uncomfortable, people are going to get upset, all the rest of it, then we can't see this kind of change. And we can't actually contemplate the ramifications, the consequences of saying we want to consider an issue such as positive discrimination.
Okay, thank you. Christian?
No, anybody else?
No. Okay. Can I move on now to Annabelle?
Thank you. And firstly, may I apologise to you and my colleagues in the committee and to you, the witnesses, for my late arrival. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I'm sorry I missed the introductory remarks, but I've picked up a lot just listening to the responses to questions. And I wasn't in any way wishing to be disrespectful, Akwugo. My own party did not actually go down that route, and yet I think we've a pretty impressive record of bringing forward females, and also one of my colleagues in the House of Lords is, of course, Baroness Nashina Mubarak, who's been a tremendous star for my party. So it's just to say I think there are other elements to this debate, and it's important to take note of that. In relation to Christian's questions about positive action. Chris, you referred to two examples, positive examples. One is positive action training and housing, and one is NHS Lothian. But what interested me was you said it got lottery funding to do whatever it's doing. And I'm curious about two things. Firstly, are these basically the only two examples we know about deploying positive action? And secondly, I mean, for the public sector, would we not expect that to be a core obligation within the public sector, which doesn't require extraneous funding?
Okay. We haven't done an audit of who are using formal positive action schemes, and those were the two examples which came to mind most readily. I've seen it pop up in different areas, in different professions, very often associated with gender, less so perhaps to do with ethnic minorities and race. I think there are a lot of areas where it potentially could be used. I referred earlier to Liam MacArthur's research on Princess head teachers in schools, and it is really quite astonishing, I think, that we have no ethnic minority head teachers in Scotland, and we don't have an awful lot of principal or deputy principals either. To me, that would seem to be an area which would be wide open for certainly exploration and potentially for development. The funding of it, I was myself a little bit surprised about the lottery funding the NHS Lothian one myself, but clearly it needs to be funded from somewhere, and they saw it as being socially desirable to do so. It's something which we would say, again, it fits inside very much the public sector duty. 270 public bodies are covered by that. Significant amount of purchasing power, significant players in the employment labour market. There's a lot that could be done by public bodies, particularly working together, not suggesting that Mid Lothian Council just goes off and does it itself, but, you know, COSLR as an organisation, the NHS as a block, FE and HE colleges working together. I think there could be significant advances that we could make of getting people to the point where they are able to compete and to come to overcome some of the perhaps some of the stereotypes that have been around before. So it's an area which has always been significantly underused, much more used in terms of gender, far less so in terms of disability, far less so in terms of race. And I think given what we see from the labour market statistics, some communities are in the position of potentially prospering, other communities are not. And the thing which I think always strikes me is that we concentrate a lot on youth, on younger people, and we concentrate to a certain degree on new arrivals into Scotland. A lot of my concern is about third, fourth generation people from Pakistani, Indian, Chinese communities who are in low-paid, segregated, long hours, low work. And I think there's an awful lot that we could and should be doing in those areas to increase their opportunities, to increase their participation, and to reduce the poverty, which we know is a significant factor linked to worklessness.
Okay, just to confirm that, I think with what Chris has said, that there are very few models of positive action in Scotland, established models. And in my experience, only the positive action in housing is the only one that I know of. I hadn't heard of the NHS one, but I also know that positive action in housing, they had tried actually to, it seems to be a model that works, and they had tried actually to extend that model to social work, to other areas, because, you know, it seems obvious, you know, if it works in one field, why can't it work in another? But I think there were issues around funding that work, because I haven't seen it being extended into other areas, and it does seem a very useful way of encouraging, of enabling more workforces to be more reflective of the local population. I wanted to say, in relation, because the issue of gender arose again, and just something around positive action, which is also around making sure that there's appropriate, affordable childcare, you know, that's also appropriate for minority groups, for women, you know, to ensure that, you know, for example, we're talking about Pakistani and Bangladeshi population, particularly where women are underrepresented in the labour market. And I think issues around childcare could play a part in that, and also need to be looked at in terms of looking at provision, childcare provision that's available, that's appropriate, culturally appropriate, and that's affordable.
Annabel?
Yep, that's very helpful, because I think you've partially answered my next question, which was the examples we have, which seem to be good examples, although there may be a small number of them, presumably if we could provide greater education to other elements of the public sector or to employers in general about these good examples of practice, then hopefully that might, you know, set the standard a bit higher and people might become more vigilant about how they approach employment policy.
Gina, and then Chris.
Well, certainly, I'm delighted to hear the focus on employers, really, the focus on educating employers and looking at that side of the equation, making sure that employers actually are equipped and equipped with the tools to recruit and to look within their workforce, as Chris alluded to, very few top jobs being held by ethnic minorities, you know, and that is an area that could, more work could be done, certainly looking at what are the blockages, where are organizations where there is ethnic minority representation, which levels is it at? One way that's been suggested is really looking at performance management systems of managers. If managers could actually be held to account to looking at the developmental needs of their staff and to ensuring that the developmental needs of their staff are met, you know, in terms of performance management frameworks, then managers themselves would take it a lot more seriously if they were held to account in that way.
That's very helpful. Okay.
And I think Chris wants to
very briefly on the issue of cost. Yes, I mean, this is very much a pump priming exercise that you are taking action over a relatively short period of time. The onus will probably fall on the public sector to fund that, but you have to balance that investment against the consequences of sustained economic inactivity, low pay, and that perception, that very, very strong perception of unfairness and the distortion in the labour market around race. So there are social consequences to this as well, and I think that if you know, yes.
Okay, Annabel, anything else?
Finally, and really, I think this is a question for Chris. What regulatory measures are the Equality and Human Rights Commission currently taking? We've heard you outline some of the opportunities and facilities available to you, but is there anything else we should know about?
Bear with me. We have recently completed not an investigation, but a large piece of research and influencing work around the cleaning sector. That was across Great Britain. We identified a number of issues, particularly around migrant labour, ethnic minority labour, but also women as well. And that particular congruence of ethnic minority women who are concentrated in the industry. We've also looked at the meat and poultry processing industry down south, very similar. We're starting to do a little bit of exploratory work just now in Scotland around fish processing and around farming, because again, it's an area where we're not going in with any expectation. We're simply going in to speak to, at this point, some of the people involved in the area. Research has thrown up a number of problems in the areas. We are looking specifically at recruitment agencies, and this issue of word-of-mouth recruitment is particularly about access in Eastern European communities and how very informal systems. We're looking at pay gaps between ethnic minority and white communities. We are doing some research around that to try and identify, well, we know there is a pay gap. We're trying to understand why there's a pay gap and what that might mean. We've also been doing a lot of work on the very associated issues of religion and belief in employment. So again, particularly barriers for Muslims, for some Christian groups. But again, so a lot of what we do is we develop evidence, we establish whether or not there is evidence in an area, and then we will tend to move either to an inquiry mode, if that's appropriate, or very much more often we will do more intensive work with the industry, we'll give guidance. I think one of the areas we've probably been most successful is in the back of meat and poultry work, where the engagement with the supermarkets has actually been the most effective intervention that we've made, is to get the supermarkets, the purchasers, to put pressure on the supply chain and say, well, actually, we're not happy about the way this is working. We want to see better social outcomes. We pride ourselves as an industry as being socially responsible, we want our suppliers to be socially responsible. And I think that the power of influence, the power, Gina described it as being embarrassment, I think there's an awful lot of soft power that we could be using in these areas, and harder power in terms of government and local authority procurement particularly, where we can start, we could really expect to see far greater outcomes for the big social and financial investment that the government and other public bodies are making.
Okay, John Mason. Oh, sorry, and Annabel, do you want to come in?
It was just to say, following on all of that, specifically, anything being done to increase awareness and understanding of positive action?
We are going to publish, this is a specific piece of work around the broadcasting industry. We have guidance on positive action, which is easily available on our website. Whether a small employer would go and look for it, I can't say. We are going to be issuing a particular piece of guidance which is tailored for the broadcasting industry. It will be launched at the Edinburgh TV Festival, during the Edinburgh Festival in August. That guidance, although it's aimed at broadcasters, is absolutely applicable for any other industry.
Thank you very much indeed. John Mason.
Yeah, it was really to go back to Dr. Emejulu's comment about positive discrimination, if I may, which I found interesting. I find myself torn, because we've just had words coming from Mr. Oswald about like soft power, influence, embarrassment, which a number of witnesses have used. And in a lot of areas, I suppose, in our equal opportunities, that's the way we go. And yet, your example of the political parties is an interesting one. And I mean, my own political party, the SNP, we a few years ago made a decision not to do that and just to kind of keep encouraging women through. And the majority of women in our party were against that. And then we've now come to the position where we're making so little progress that a decision's been made to do it. And I think Labour were ahead of us on that one. I just wonder, does there come a time when the softly, softly, gentle, gentle approach, we just feel we're not making progress, we're going to have to do something more dramatic, which at the moment is illegal, but obviously the law could be changed.
Akwugo, do you want to comment?
Well, I think I know what you're going to say.
Oh, you know my point. I think that's the point for Chris. Absolutely.
Chris? Or is that a rhetorical question? Would you prefer not to comment, Chris?
No. I mean, we've looked at this in terms of the proposals around women on boards and public appointments in Scotland. Our position is that currently, as the law stands, it would be unlawful to do this. So we would need to change the law to enable that to go forward. We're a regulator. We don't make policy in that sense. What I would say, and what we put in our submission very strongly, was that we need to have a discussion about this as a country. If we're going to do this, let's do this consciously. Let's not just talk about gender. Let's talk about ethnicity. Let's talk about disability, because the evidence of disparity of outcomes is just as strong in those areas as it is around gender. But we need to be conscious about what we're doing, and I would strongly suggest that we don't do it in a piecemeal way. It has had a significant impact, a positive impact in America, in creating, as Akwugo referred to, as a black middle class, which wasn't there before. But if we're going to do this, let's be very, very conscious of what we're doing, because it's a major departure from British and European practice that's been built up over 30 or 40 years. I'm not saying don't do it. I'm just saying let's be very conscious about it, and we need to have a very large conversation, because there are negative associations and hostility to the concept.
You mentioned disability, and we used to have a target, am I right, in saying for disability. Was it 3 or 4%?
That was tied up with the two ticks thing. It was 3%.
Right. Did that not work, or why was it dropped? I can't remember.
I think a lot of disabled activists said it was patronising, that they didn't want to be, and also they felt that it could become a ceiling rather than a floor, that it was effectively a quota that was being introduced. And again, simply saying we want to have X percentage of the workforce from a particular group doesn't necessarily get you around the barriers for the rest of those people who are trying to come up. So we need to look much more carefully at the systems that are in place. Women may not be succeeding because of upfront sexism. They also may not be succeeding because of a lack of affordable childcare, because of the way that the workplace is organised, because of subtle assumptions that are being made. I think we said earlier on, and I think this is the experience in the Ethnic Minority Law Centre, that sometimes as litigators, it's incredibly rare that we see upfront discrimination, somebody being told, you're not getting this job because of your colour. It's just, it's very rare these days. It's much more subtle, and it's much more harder to find.
Okay. Finished, John?
I think so, yes.
Yep. Thank you. Can I ask Chris as well, you've mentioned a few times about procurement, and at the start you says that colleges, training providers, through the procurement process, this should be looked at as, and maybe a percentage of the modern apprentices should come from ethnic minority backgrounds. And John Mason mentioned as well in passing that it's employers that recruit the individuals for the modern apprenticeship programme. I don't see how, maybe you can explain to us, how by targeting train providers, including colleges, who have the contracts to deliver the modern apprenticeship programme, that they can actually achieve those targets set through the procurement process if it's down to employers to actually recruit the apprentices?
I was under that impression myself, and I'm speaking to Skills Development Scotland, they assure me that you do not have to be in employment to access a modern apprenticeship. So,
I think I've got to actually, well, declare an interest because I did work in that field, and to be a modern apprentice, you do have to be employed.
That was always my understanding well, but when I speak to, it may be something you'd want to ask Skills Development Scotland when they come through.
Yeah.
I would say that with the Employability Fund, which is less prescriptive in terms of whether or not you need to have an employer, the ethnic minority participation rate is 2%.
Yeah.
So it doesn't even make a huge difference. I think one of the issues which comes up though with modern apprenticeships is that if we know that Indian people, Chinese people are particularly concentrated in an industry, catering, wholesale, retail, what is being done to encourage that industry to put forward candidates for modern apprenticeships?
Yeah. And that would then come back to Skills Development Scotland, because they actually determine what occupational areas they would actually fund, and things like the manufacturing processes and the care they do. I believe that is one of the occupational areas they do actually cover. So that would be achievable then. What about other areas of procurement you're talking about as well, for the government to look at through the procurement process? What can be done that way to encourage more uptake of ethnic minorities? Maybe Gina?
Yes. I mean, a lot of low-paid work is actually outsourced, you know, cleaning, catering, all of that's outsourced. It's sort of making sure that people in those occupations throughout public sector organisations can do a lot of contracting in of work in those sectors. And it's making sure that, for example, that those suppliers are paying the living wage, you know, making sure that they have equal opportunities policies and processes within their workforce. So that, I suppose, is the carrot, you know, the kind of carrot approach, you know, saying, I don't think you can actually force suppliers to do that, but you can certainly encourage them to do that and ask them at contract renewal time, so what have you done, you know. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Does any of the members have any other questions they would like to ask the witnesses? No. We do have a bit of time if any of the witnesses would like to give us some other information they feel that's important that actually hasn't come out during this session. You've got time just now. Does anybody like to say anything? No? Okay. Right, if you do, when you go away and you realise there's points that you want to put across that actually haven't came through in the sort of question and answer session, please write to us and give us any more information you feel would be benefit to the committee and our inquiry. But I would now like to actually close the meeting, and I'd like to thank you all for coming and giving us such really valuable insight and information into the situation. And that concludes today's meeting. Our next meeting will take place on the 3rd of September, and I now close the meeting. Thank you.